Happy Easter. He is risen. He's risen indeed, right? I'm so thankful that you're here. We're going to learn today four great Easter principles to set your life in a brand new direction. You're at California Community Church. I'm glad that you are. I'm Pastor Brad. I want to welcome you here. If you're online, I want to welcome you here. I mean, it's a great day. Now, when you came on campus, you were expecting to see our petting zoo all set up and ready to go, and they're running behind. You know, I was just thinking, if I was Noah, and I'm loading these things on the ark, if they're late, I just shut the door. I mean, it's just not good, you know, for the animals to be late. But what I've been told is they'll be there when we're done. I hope so. I want you to enjoy that. I'm glad you're here. Kids have Easter baskets upstairs. We've got balloon shaping going on for the kids. They're going to have a great time regardless. But I'm hoping that petting zoo gets in place because I've looked forward to that myself. Just a heads up, a little later in the service, we're going to take communion together. And when you came in, you should have been handed, if you want to take communion, you should have been given one of these little cups. If you did not get one, would you just raise your hand? We'd like you to have it so you'll be ready over here. Make sure you have one of these if you'd like to participate in communion. We'll have that for you. And for those of you who are online, if you want to right now, just run and get something to drink and a cracker or a piece of bread or something where you can take communion with us. You'll be ready during that time too. And I just want to say a quick thank you to Donna Bice, our executive pastor, who has led all of our Easter planning, all of our Easter teams. I mean, she's the one that made it gel and coalesce along with all of our volunteers. Could you just join me in saying a great big thank you? Now, we're celebrating Easter. I mean, this is a great holiday because if not for what happened at Easter, then Christmas would actually have no meaning. I mean, think about that. It was just like, well, a baby was born. Okay, big deal. But it was this baby born for a specific purpose, and the purpose was manifest at Easter. Like, we came to know why Jesus came at Christmas when finally, 33 years later, this happened in the spring of that year. Like, not only would Christmas have no meaning without Easter, your faith would have no meaning without Easter. The scripture says, if Jesus wasn't raised from the dead, we're wasting our time. Then why are we here? Why did we open the doors and turn on the lights? We're here because of a historical fact that what Jesus did in raising from the dead is the game-changing event in history. It proved the identity of Jesus. He said, I'm the Son of God. I'll prove it by raising from the dead. He proved it. It shows the power of Jesus. Like, if he can overcome death, he can overcome anything you carried in with you today. Any burden that you're worried about today, like if he can do that, overcome death, he can do what you need in your life today. What Jesus did on the cross set us free from our sin. He paid the penalty so that we could be forgiven and made right with God. I mean, that's not bad for a hard weekend of work, right? I mean, Jesus really pulled it off, and that's just fantastic. Now, you're here today because you believe that. Or you're here today because you're curious about that. Or you're here today because you have a drug problem. Somebody drug you here, and that's why you're here. And, you know, whatever category, like it doesn't matter. You know, whatever category, regardless why you're here, what we're going to learn today can be so impactful. These four perspectives on Easter, I don't think you've ever considered these before. And these are four principles that can set your life in a better direction and on a better course for the rest of your life. And I'm excited to jump in. If you've got your little form, your outline with you, I want you to have that ready. We're going to get to work. Look at number one. There is a knowing that will get you past all the no's that you face in your life. There is a knowing. Like when you know something for certain, doesn't matter what anybody else thinks. When you know something for certain, doesn't matter if somebody else wants you to do it or not. Like your knowing is what helps you keep going in your life. This all starts with the example of Jesus. There was a knowledge that Jesus had. There was a deep certainty that Jesus had, a knowing that directed his life. Look what Jesus said. Jesus said, I know where I came from. And then let's just say this next part together. And I know where I'm going. Like if you study his life, you see this knowing. There is an intention about the life of Jesus. There is a certainty about what he was doing, what he would be doing next. All of his days had this clarity and had direction. Like at no other time in his 33 years of life was this more apparent, I think, than in the final week of his life. Now, if you were here last weekend, we talked about this just a little bit. It was widely reported that the religious leaders who were in Jerusalem were jealous of Jesus and they wanted to kill Jesus. Like everybody knew that. He was threatening to them. They were threatened by Jesus' authority. They were threatened by Jesus' popularity. They were threatened by his ability to perform miracles. They were threatened most of all by his ability to see into their hearts and to see how corrupt they were. So word went out that if anybody knew where Jesus was, if anybody knew when he would be close to Jerusalem again, to let this certain group of authorities know that. There might even be a little money in it for somebody. If they would just tell where Jesus was. And these leaders said, then we'll make sure that he's captured and we'll make sure that he's killed. Now listen. Jesus knew what was waiting for him in Jerusalem. He knew what was happening, but he also knew, this is why I came. This is the reason I came to earth. I didn't come to live a comfortable life. I came to offer my life as a sacrifice for the sins of people. He came to buy off the penalty of our wrongdoing. He paid with his life what it cost to have our sins forgiven. He paid that price. Listen. He lived knowing that he came to earth to give his life. And it was this knowing that kept him going toward Jerusalem. I like that. His knowing kept him going. Say it with me. His knowing kept him going. And the same thing would be true for you. Now, I don't want you to miss this. Jesus' closest friends didn't agree with the direction of his life. They objected to him going to Jerusalem. But Jesus, like a guided missile, was locked on. I mean, this guy was locked on. But their objections persisted. I mean, they went on days before he arrived and miles before he arrived. If you were to sum up the objections of the disciples, they would sound like this. Can't we just keep doing what we've always done? Can't we just keep the status quo? Why are you taking such a big risk with your life and with our life? We don't want to change. Aren't we fine just the way we are? Now, I think most of us understand this sentiment. Few of us want things to change. Few of us want to do what's required to grow. But listen, growth requires change. And change is scary. We have to face our fears so we can change, so that we can what? So that we can grow. When people were saying no to Jesus, their objections didn't stop him because he had this knowing. Did you know this is how you accomplish anything great in your life? The greatest contribution of one's life will be met with a no. Somebody will say, no, don't do it. No, don't change. No, just stay the way you are. No, let's not rock the boat. No, let's just maintain the status quo. But the greatest achievements of your life will occur because you know that what you're doing, you're supposed to do. You know that what you're doing, you were destined to do. You know that you're in the sweet spot of what you were created to do. So it doesn't matter if somebody says no, because you have your knowing. I'm going to give you an example. One of the followers of Jesus learned this the hard way. His name was Simon Peter. When Jesus finally got to Jerusalem on Friday evening, he was arrested and he was bound over for trial. He was led to the city center and Peter followed from a distance. He didn't want to be too close because he might get arrested too, but he wanted to be close enough so he could see what happened to Jesus. And they had street fires back then, like on the dirt streets, they'd build these little fires. I mean, you see this sometimes around homeless encampments. They'll set a trash can on fire just to warm themselves. And it was like that. It's like a trash fire. And Peter's there and he's warming himself, but he's at a place where he can keep an eye on things. And look what happened. A servant girl asked Peter, "You aren't one of this man's disciples too, are you?" She asked Peter. He replied, "I'm not." Meanwhile, Simon Peter was still standing there warming himself. So they asked him, more people, you aren't one of his disciples too, are you? He denied it. No, I'm not. One of the high priest's servants challenged him. Didn't I see you with him in the garden? And again, Peter denied it. Now, this is kind of remarkable if you look at the life of Peter, because Peter was the one disciple who, when Jesus asked the question, who do people say that I am? Peter is the one who responded, well, you're the Christ. You're the Son of the living God. It seemed like Peter had a knowing. It seemed like he knew that. Peter's the one back at the garden when Jesus was arrested, who pulled out a sword and started swinging. He was so confident that he needed to protect Jesus because he thought he knew who Jesus was. Peter had a level of certainty. Peter had a level of knowing. But then when he's confronted, and then when he's afraid, we see that his knowing isn't yet fully formed. We see that he doesn't have that solid certainty. The knowing who Jesus was not the operating system of his life just yet. And he gave in to fear. He gave in to the no's. Now, how do you turn a no into knowing? The resurrection. Resurrection changes everything. See, the resurrection for Peter, like before, he's kind of like, I think I know who you are. I think I know what I'm supposed to do. I think I know what you came to do. I think I know. But then, I don't know it enough where I'm like going to risk my life for it. That's why he denied Jesus. He was afraid. But after the resurrection, check that dude out. Peter's so bold. Beatings did not stop him from telling other people about Jesus after the resurrection, because now he knows. The threats of imprisonment didn't stop him from telling people about Jesus, because now he knows. The threat of his own death didn't stop Peter from telling other people about Jesus, because now he knows. His knowing became solid, and he faced down so many objections and so many no's of others. Now let's just apply this at a micro level to your life, like just in your daily life. What you know to be true about your life, what you know to be true about what you're doing with your life, what you know to be certain about a decision you're making in business or a commitment that you're holding to with your family, knowing it's right, knowing what you're supposed to do is what keeps you steady, and it's what brings you success. Now, on the macro level, the larger side of life, it has everything to do with your spiritual well-being. It's knowing that Jesus is God's Son. It's knowing that he died for your sins. It's knowing that he rose from the dead that changes the course of your loyalty to him and your devotion to him and your obedience to him. See, the cross and the resurrection didn't just change history. It changed me. And it changed many of you. And it can change all of you when you make a declaration, I know Jesus is God's Son. I know he died on a cross for my sins. I know he rose from the dead. Right now, we're going to renew our knowing by observing communion together. If you want to participate, you're going to want to have your cup. And let me just ask you again, does anybody still need one? Anybody need one of these? And then I hope those of you at home are there too. I want to give you just a little instruction. On the bottom of the cup, like you turn it over, you pull off the thing. There's a little piece of bread under that. And then you flip it back up and you pull off the top. And that's how you can access the juice. Like some of you understand the symbolism, this tiny juice is so symbolic because the red color is a picture of the graphic brutality of crucifixion. Jesus literally bled out. I mean, think about that color. Jesus literally bled out to atone for our sins, to make the payment required for our forgiveness. He died for you. A little piece of bread is symbolic of the torture that his body went through, the trauma that was inflicted on him for you. And the scripture says this, for whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you tell others about the death of Jesus until he comes back. See, communion is a backward look. like we're talking about his death, but communion's also a forward look because it talks about his second coming. He's coming back because he's alive. So it's with gratitude that we take the juice and the bread. And as you take communion right now, I want you to just whisper, thank you, Jesus, for everything you've done for me. Thank you, Jesus, for everything you've done for me. Just whisper that as you eat the bread and as you drink the cup. Amen. And amen. Now I want to talk to you about life after death. But we can't talk about life after death until we first talk about doubt after death. I want you to think about Easter weekend. You know, everybody knows about Good Friday. Oh, Good Friday. We say Good Friday. Everybody knows about Resurrection Sunday. Oh, can't wait for Resurrection Sunday. We've got Good Friday. We've got Resurrection Sunday. But what are we missing? We're missing Doubting Saturday. Can you imagine? For the followers of Jesus Christ, the crucifixion was the death of their dreams. I don't know if you've ever thought about that, but they had pinned 3 years of their life and all their future on their belief that Jesus was the promised Messiah. They'd come to believe that. They had believed that he was mighty, that he was their answer. But then they saw him die. I mean, you've maybe had small glimpses of what it might feel like to have a dream die, to have your life seemingly come to a sudden and abrupt halt. Some of you have experienced that in your own life in a circumstance. Like I know people who dreamed of playing professional sports until they had a career-ending injury and it left them doubting their ability or had a lot of uncertainty about what their future would be. Some of you built a dream business. And then you remember the day you had to shutter it. And it left a lasting doubt in you about who you are and what you can achieve. Some of you built a marriage that collapsed and it left a lasting doubt in you about your lovability or your choices. And it's that feeling of doubt. Like this is where we find the disciples on Saturday. They're back in their houses. They're back in their hometowns. They're back with friends who didn't think they should have followed Jesus in the first place. They're back to their old lives that they never thought they'd have to return to. And they're embarrassed about that and they're uncertain about that. They didn't know where to find their answers. All they had left were their doubts. I mean, where do you turn? Who do you talk to? Who can guide you? I mean, is there anyone? Is there anyone? Demi Lovato wrote a song that is very haunting, and it's about all of these what I call Saturday feelings, the feelings that had to be there, loneliness, despair, cries for help, and a lot of doubt. Brent and Adele from our church are going to come and share this amazing song with us.
Get it wrong, I feel stupid when I pray. Why am tried too many times. I just need some more affection. Anything to get me by. 100 million stories and 100 million songs. I feel stupid when I sing.
Felt that. I mean, that pathos, that emotion, that doubt, that's what was happening. Like, before we can ever talk about life after death, we have to talk about doubt after death. So to review, there's number one, there's the knowing. That'll get you through all the no's that you face in life. And then there's the doubt that comes after death. But then look at number three, and this mindset can actually change everything. If I can believe God's divine plan isn't stopped by the circumstances I see, I can believe something good is happening behind the scenes, and that good thing is heading my way. See, we get to live on this side of the resurrection. Like, we're not living when they did, where they didn't know about resurrection. They didn't know what that would be. They didn't have that perspective. We now have it. And here's what I mean by that. I want us to play like a little imagination game for just a second. I want you to imagine that you're kind of hovering above this story back in the first century. Jesus is dead and buried. The disciples have now returned back to their old lives. They're embarrassed and dejected, and heads are hanging. They're kind of ashamed that they gave 3 years to that. They're questioning who God is or if he's real. I mean, I want you to imagine that, and you're hovering above this scene, and you're watching them live their lives. They're shuffling and sad and doubting. But you're hovering above this. You can see them. At the same time, you look across town and you can see the burial tomb of Jesus. Like, simultaneously, you can see the sad disciples and you can see the tomb. And I want you to imagine Jesus kind of laying on that carved stone shelf inside that cave. And I want you to imagine that you can see him sit up. And then you see him stand. And then I want you to imagine that he walks over to the boulder that's sealing the entrance to the tomb, and he just moves it out of the way. Now, I want you to get this. Simultaneously, you see the sad disciples who had no idea that across town something great is happening. They had no idea about the change that was coming their way. No idea what God was doing behind the scenes for them. But here you are now watching all of it. Jesus alive and sad disciples. Don't you just want to yell from that perch? Hey, don't be sad. Hey, stop doubting. Don't live that way. Don't be dejected. You wouldn't live like that if you only knew the good that is already on its way to you. And it's going to change everything. There's so many little examples of this you've probably seen in your own life. An unexpected check lands in your mailbox just when you need it. But the point you can't miss is this: that check was mailed way before the day you needed it. It was already on the way when you were wondering, how am I going to make it? How am I going to provide? What's going to happen? And something good was already on the way before you even knew that it was on the way. Or a job offer is made and it's perfect for you. But what you can't miss is that not too long ago, somebody else occupied that job. The job wasn't available, but then that person, for whatever reason, vacated that job and the job was open. You didn't even know about the job and you didn't know it was open. You might have not known you were going to need a job. But your need and that opening arrived at the same time, but you need to understand it was there before you knew it was there. Everything you will ever need in life is there before you need it, before you even know you need it. This is what resurrection does for us. It's living with the belief that the circumstances we see are not all that's going on. No matter how bad the circumstances are, they aren't everything. And we believe, because of the resurrection, that behind what we can see, there is divine good being prepared for us, and it's on its way to us. See what this does? It turns doubt to hope. And we can survive anything if we have hope. Listen, your life isn't designed to stay stuck in the past. Your life is not designed to stay stuck where you are. Your life is designed for forward progress, for forward momentum. You say, well, Brad, it doesn't feel like it. It feels like I'm just stuck right where I am. Well, listen, if you're stuck where you are, you're operating against your design. You're meant for more than that. You're meant for the future God has for you. You are designed for potential and for progress. There's an interesting story of two men who are from the Middle Eastern town called Emmaus. And they're walking home. And this is after they had seen Jesus killed in Jerusalem. And now they're doubting as well. And as they're walking along, this is Resurrection Sunday. Jesus had already raised from the dead that morning. They just don't know it. And as they're walking toward their home back to Emmaus, a stranger joins them on the road. It's Jesus, but they don't recognize yet that it's Jesus, because of where their minds were. They weren't looking for Jesus. Their minds and their hearts were still in their past. Their thoughts were in the past. Their emotions were in the past. Their conversation that afternoon was all about the past. They weren't living according to their design. They didn't have hope for their future until they recognized Jesus. And then their thoughts moved from the past and were filled with hope. When you're stuck, you have to tap into this belief that good is prepared and that good is coming. You have to believe that good is prepared and that good is coming. Let's say it together. Good is prepared and good is coming. Follow me here. Because good is coming, you don't have to stay stuck. You can now take a step. You can do something. You may not know the whole plan. You may not know the whole path. But because you believe good is coming, I'm going to step out to meet it. I'm going to step into my future, trusting that God's design is going to meet me in that place. You step out in faith. When you doubt, you stay stuck. But when you take a step, you're showing faith. Don't doubt, do. Don't doubt, do. Listen, you go through life, you think you're confident. You think you're knowing what you should do. You think you know where your life is going. You think you know the dream that you should pursue. But then life throws you a curveball. There's a death, there's a setback, there's a failure, there's a roadblock. And what you were once so certain of, now you doubt. But then you believe the truth that God is always working in ways we can't see. And that hope is all we need. The hope that God's good is already on its way to me. That hope. You grab that hope and you take a step forward. And after all that, watch what happens. Number four, the level you're at after the tomb, the death of that dream, living in that stuck place. After that, your life always rises. It's always higher. This is remarkable. We think that the process of our dream dying, our life crashing and burning, we think that's just going to leave us broken down, like that's the end of the road, end of the story. No, it's not. Those experiences can actually elevate us. It doesn't have to leave you permanently broken. When your life is filled with belief and hope and faith, you know that no matter what happens, you can emerge from that better and not bitter. Think how different Jesus was after the resurrection than before the resurrection. I mean, I just give you an example. Like one of the things, he was able to get through barriers. Like this is very interesting. I want you to look at this. Here's a story. It was late that Sunday. So this is the Sunday where Jesus rose that morning. The disciples don't know about this. They're afraid that because Jesus was arrested, they're going to be arrested. So they go into hiding. And look at this. It was late that Sunday evening. The disciples were gathered together. Now notice where they are. Behind locked doors. Why? Because they're afraid. They're living in the past. Jesus came and stood among them. I want you to know the door was what? The door was locked. And all of a sudden, Jesus is standing in a room that was designed to keep him out. But apparently, once you've come out of a tomb, a barrier doesn't stop you. A wall isn't sufficient to hold you back. Closed door, not a problem. Jesus is now operating at a higher plane. He's elevated. He's leveled up. And when you go through your fire, when you go through your trials, when you go through your broken heart and your broken dreams, you can emerge better. It levels you up. This is how we have to learn to view our pain and our problems. Now, we're not going to call pain and problems good. We're not living in denial or in some Pollyanna, you know, alternate reality. We're not saying that bad things are good. What we are saying is that bad can lead to good. That divorce, bet that helped you make a better choice the next time. And if it didn't, have you ever noticed how life has a way of coming back around again and again till you do get it? That business collapses, that season of physical rehab, we think those things could leave us just ruined. But think about what those circumstances bring to our life. They bring perspective. They bring confidence. They bring humility. They bring gratitude. I mean, here's how that process works in your life. First, there's the wound. I mean, this is everything that has hurt you. This is everything painful and sad and heartbreaking about your life. Everything that's wounded you. And then after the wound, there's the tomb. This is where all seems lost. Life as you know it has stopped, and most of it has died. All seems lost. But then we find that the tomb is actually a womb. It's a portal to a better life. It's the birth of a new chapter. It's the beginning of something, not the end of something. Jesus stepped from the tomb not as a convicted criminal, but the ancient Christian scripture says after the tomb, he was given a name that's above all other names, and he was put in a position of highest honor and is so elevated that everybody will acknowledge that he is Lord. Jesus leveled up. And in your life and mine, the wound and the tomb also is a womb. That which was meant to kill you made you stronger. made you wiser, more confident, more humble, more grateful. And some of you have learned that after that pain, your life is better than you ever imagined. See, some of you right now are in what's called the liminal space. I don't know if you know that word, the liminal space. That's a threshold you cross from where you are to where you're going. It's like a bridge. It's like a path. It's like that middle ground from who you are to who you're becoming. Right now, you maybe are wounded by people. That's where you are. You're wounded by your circumstances and by life. That's where you are. Some of you right now, your hopes and your dreams are dying or they're dead. You think you're in a tomb. But today you realize that's not a tomb. That's a womb. This is the entry for the next chapter of my life. This is what offers promise and possibility and hope. That my life can be better than it ever was before. This is where we need to make this resurrection truth personal. We need to make it personal. Like if you leave today and all you got out of this is, well, the resurrection was a historical event, then you miss the point. You've got to move it from being historical to personal. I want you to imagine your tomb. I mean, what is it that you feel is killing you? What is it that you feel is breaking you? What is it that you know is hurting you? I mean, is it that job that you just can't stand? Are you in that marital season where there's just so much work and you're not sure you can get through it? Do you feel the lack of confidence? Do you not feel that you're enough? Are you in a season where you're just feeling overwhelmed and buried by it all? Whatever it is, that's your tomb. And it's meant to defeat you. It's your liminal space between who you are and who you're becoming. So just imagine yourself in that dark place. You say, brother, it doesn't take a lot of imagination. I'm feeling it. Imagine your future laid out dead on a cold stone slab in a burial cave. Now, here's the cool part. Imagine yourself sitting up. Imagine yourself rising. Try to imagine what it feels like to come back to life. You walk over to the boulder that's blocking your way, and you move it. I mean, can you imagine? And you step into the light of day and the sun is warm on your face and you realize you just came back to life. And there's a bright future waiting for you. And you're standing there. And life's ahead of you again. And there's one more part to this. You have to decide what's the first thing you'd do to start your brand new life. Who's the first person you'd talk to about what you're going to do now that you have another chance? Now that you have a new lease on life? Now that you have a fresh start? What are the first two things that you would do? You're not going to go back to the life you left behind. What are you going to do to start your brand new life? And this is your personal Easter moment. Like right now, you decide right now that with Jesus' power, you can begin new today. I can begin new today. Say it with me. I can begin new today. You see, this isn't just some historical event. This is your story. This is your life we're talking about. This is your beginning that starts right now. This is your Easter. Let's pray together. Father God, thank you so, so very much for everything that Jesus means to us and everything he went through for us. And as grateful as we are for the historical truth of that. We have to roll it forward. 2023. Into our life right now, that same power, that same access to a brand new, elevated way of living. It's available. We just have to step into it. Out of the past, out of the tomb, through the womb, into the bright new day. Father, sear that image into our hearts. Drive it deeply, Father, into our belief. Raise our faith. You have a brand new life for us. We're going to step into it today. Today, I'm beginning new. Today, I'm beginning new. Whoever wants to say that with me, say it with me. Today, I'm beginning new. And that is the message of Easter. In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen and amen.